长带来的报告是，西汉王侯的地下奢华，海昏侯墓的考古发掘。
Ladies and gentlemen, today I bring to you underground treasures of the Western Han Marquis, excavation of the Haifun Hou tomb.
南昌西汉海昏侯墓，我今天报告的内容分四部分：第一，发现；第二，收获；第三，理念；第四，价值。
My presentation today will be divided into four parts. First one is discovery of the tomb, and second one is findings, third ideals, and finally the value of this discovery.
第一部分，发现，南昌西汉海昏侯墓，位于江西省南昌市北面大约60公里的地方。
So I'll start with the discovery. The tomb of the Marquis of Haifun is located in 60 kilometers north of the Nanchang city in Jiangxi province.
它北面是中国第一大的淡水湖鄱阳湖，它的东面是中国最大的一条江长江的支流赣江。
This area to its north has one of the largest lakes in China, which is Huoyang Hu, and then to its east it has the largest river in China, which is Yangtze River.
海昏侯墓的发现是因为2011年3月，在他的在墓葬的所在地郭墩山上，因的古墓被盗，当地村民举报，我们江西省文物考古研究所闻讯之后，立即派人对被盗墓葬进行调查和勘探。
The discovery of the tomb roots in 2011 when the Archaeological Institute of Jiangxi received the report from nearby villagers that the ancient tomb on the Guodun Mountain is being looted. And upon hearing the news, they sent experts there to protect the site.
这是当时被盗墓葬的盗洞情况，和盗洞对祖国打在墓穴的国史的那个位置。
This is the photo of the robber's tunnel at the moment of its discovery, and the other image of the tomb shows the location of where the robber's tunnel penetrated the tomb chamber.
江西省文物考古研究所立即向国家文物局汇报，国家文物局立即组织了专家进行论证，在经过慎重研究之后批准了这一次发掘。
So upon discovery, experts from the Archaeological Institute of Jiangxi reported to the central government cultural bureaus about the discovery, which had a discussion about its value, and after which it was decided that excavation to be taken place immediately.
第二部分，我报告的内容是收获。从海昏侯墓从2011年到现在为止，目前经过了将近6年的发掘，我们共调查和勘探了400万平方米，发掘10000平方米，考古工作取得了重大的收获。
So now I'm going to talk about findings from the tomb of Marquis of Haifun. Since its original discovery in 2011, it's been 6 years that the archaeological process has been taking place, and we have investigated around 4 million square meters of area, and about 10,000 square meters of which we have excavated.
从目前的考古发掘情况表明，南昌西汉海昏侯墓的主人为西汉第一代海昏侯刘贺。
From the findings, we know were able to determine that the tomb owner is the first generation of Marquis of Haifun, whose name is Liu He.
Liu He is the 汉朝的第九个皇帝。
Liu He is the ninth emperor of the Western Han Dynasty.
他是 汉武帝和他最宠爱的一个夫人李夫人的孙子。
He's the grandson of the Emperor Wu of Han and his favorite consort, Madame Li.
他的父亲就是汉武帝和李夫人的儿子，第一代昌邑王刘伯。
Liu Bo's father is the son of Emperor Wu of Han and Madame Li, Liu Bo, who was the first generation of the king of Changyi.
因为，刘贺六岁继昌邑王位。
Because Liu Bo succeeded the kingship of the Changyi kingdom at the age of six.
在昭帝，昭帝去世后。昭帝因为死得早，没有继承人，所以当时的大将军霍光把刘贺从山东昌邑请到长安做了皇帝。
Because Emperor Zhao of Han, who was the successor of the Emperor Wu, died at very young age without offsprings. The very powerful minister Huo Guang at that time invited Liu He to back to the capital from Shandong to succeed the throne.
后因为按的文献记载，因为刘贺当了皇帝的时候，行淫乱，乱汉制度，动作无节，最后被霍光废除了帝位。
And according to historical texts, because Liu He's behaviors was incredibly corrupt, Huo Guang, after only 27 days of his reign, Huo Guang sort of made sure that he was dethroned.
他只在皇帝位上只坐了27天。
He was only the emperor for 27 days.
据文献记载说，他坐了27天，做了1127件坏事。
According to the historical text, during his 27-day reign, he committed 1,127 misdeeds. Yes.
霍光就把他重新送回他原来的原来的昌邑王的故地，就山东昌邑，变成了一个庶民，就是平民。
Therefore, the powerful minister Huo Guang again sent him back to his original where he came from, which is the Changyi Kingdom in Shandong, and demoted him to a commoner status.
在十年之后，宣帝的另外就是元帝的时候，宣帝十年之后，宣帝重新把刘贺从山东改封到鄱阳府当第一代海昏侯。
After 10 years, the new emperor Xuan of Han sort of transferred Liu He from his own kingdom, which is Changyi Kingdom, to the area of Huoyanghu to become the first Marquess of Haifeng.
据颁布《汉书》记载，刘贺在鄱阳府，他的海昏侯的爵位至少传了四代。
So according to the 汉书白班固the position that the lordship that Liu He held, which is the Marquess of Haifeng, had four generations, at least four generations of successors.
他第二代是刘代宗，第三代是刘保世，第四代是刘会义。
So on the screen you can see the three other generations of his offsprings who succeeded the Marquess of Haifeng.
我们从刘贺西爵为王，改封海丰的整个这样一个过程当中，使刘贺成为西汉历史上最具传奇的人物之一，也就最具争议的人物之一。
Because of his original ascension to become a king and then an emperor and then to the commoner and then back into the marquess, he has become one of the most legendary and at the same time controversial figure in Western history.
我们从这张图上就可以看到，他的整个海昏侯刘贺的迁徙路线，他是在山东，是第二代昌邑王，最后到长安当了27天皇帝， 最后又回到山东昌邑，成为一个庶民。十年之后，被宣帝改封到鄱阳侯，当第一代海昏侯。这是整个刘贺的一个迁徙的一个路线。
On this map, it's map Liu He's route of promotion and demotion in a way. He comes from Shandong on the right, Junye Changyi Kingdom, and goes to the capital to become the emperor. Then goes back there to become a commoner, and finally sent down to the Haifeng Kingdom there to become the first generation of the Marquess of Haifeng.
经过我们六年的调查勘探和发掘，我们发现了紫禁城城址历代海昏侯墓区贵族和大量的贵族和平民的墓葬。
Through the 6 years of investigation, we have discovered in the area the remains of the city, Zijin City, which was the capital of the Haifeng Kingdom, as well as the cemeteries of the four generations of the Marquess of Haifeng and cemeteries of local aristocrats and commoners.
这样，我们这次发掘并不是仅仅的发掘一座墓葬，最后通过这样的工作，我们是把它作为一个海昏侯国的遗址来进行发掘的。
So this process has become not only an excavation of the tomb itself, but also the excavation of larger kingdom of Haifeng as a whole, in a sense.
这是当时的海昏侯国的都邑遗址。
So what I'm pointing here at the screen is the remains of the Zijin city.
它的西面和南面是四代海昏侯的墓葬区。
To its west and south are the cemeteries of the four generations of the Marquess of Haifeng.
在四代海昏侯墓葬区的西面和南面还有大量的贵族和平民墓地。
Further to the west and the south, there we can see the cemeteries for aristocrats as well as commoners.
整个海昏侯国的都邑遗址面积大约5到7平方公里。
So the entire site for the Zijin City and the Haifeng Kingdom capital, this area has about 5 to 7 square kilometers of area.
这是它的都邑，紫禁城城址，它占地是3.6平方公里。
This is the this map shows the area of the Haifeng Kingdom capital. And the area is about 3.6 square kilometers in total.
它由外层和内层两部分组成。
It has two. 你们是城墙是吧？
外层和内层。
Okay, so the city has two divided into two parts, which is the outer city as and the inner city.
内层位于城区的东部。
The inner city is located to the east of the city.
由两座东西小城组成。
And it's divided into the western and eastern smaller segments.
在内层的在内层区域，我们发现了大量的建筑遗址。
In the inner city, on the east side, we have discovered a large amount of remains of archaeological architectural remains.
初步推测有可能是宫殿遗迹。
Our first theory is that these are the remains of the Haifeng Palace.
这是内层发现的遗迹的一个平面图。
This is a visualization of the palatial remains in the inner city.
这是我们的一个复原的模型。
This is one of our reconstructions of the remains of the site.
紫禁城的第二个特点是。它的都城的第二个特点是双重城墙。
The second character feature of the Zijin City is that it has two layers of city walls.
整个城墙的高度目前还最高的地方还残存有2米多高。
at its tallest point, the remains of the city wall still has about 2 meters left.
而且它双层城墙之间的间距最大的地方有28米。
And the distance between the two layers of city walls could reach as wide as 28 meters.
这是它的东城墙一段的我们的钻探的解剖，这是剖面。
This is a this is a cross section of the eastern section of the city wall, and you can see the two layers here distributed to the left and right.
海丰侯都邑的第三个特点，它是以水路交通为主。
The third feature of the Zijin City is that its main transportation route is based on water courses.
我们目前勘探调查的结果，我们共发现河道21条，其中有12条流经了缺口处。
Based on our investigation so far, we have discovered 21 water courses inside the city wall, and 12 of which sort of penetrates the city walls and flows out.
在河道旁边的高地上，我们大约发现了十处，有八处那个夯土机制，可能和当时的码头遗迹有关。
On the higher sections of the next close to the waterways, we have discovered about 8 sites that has rammed earth foundations, which we suspect to be originally docks.
这是整个河道的一个复原。
This is the reconstruction of the original waterways inside the city wall, and you can see barely on the sides the remains of the city wall. So you can see that literally the city wall surrounds these water courses.
同时，在海丰侯国都的西面和南面，目前有发现，根据勘探和调查的结果，有发现有4座，是有墓园的。 他们是苏家山、波敦、池塘岗和发古敦，这是四代海丰侯的墓园初步判断。So
to the west of the and the south of the Zijin City, we have discovered 4 cemeteries of the Marquis of Haikun, and there are 波敦山、苏家山 and 池塘岗 and 发古敦 4 hills.
在他们的西面和南面，还有大约发现了24处贵族和平民墓地。
Next to these remains, we have also discovered about 24 sites of aristocratic as well as commoner cemetery.
这是海丰侯墓园的一个平面图。This
is the plan for the 海丰侯 cemetery.
海丰侯墓园是以海丰侯和海丰侯夫人为中心建成的，共占地4.6万平方米。整个墓园墙的周长868米，等于在它有北门和东门，门外有对称的商榭。以海丰侯墓园之内，还发现7座辅葬墓和1条外长坑，以及大量的。 建筑基址和道路和排水的遗迹。
We have this is the plan, and then the cemetery is constructed taking the tomb of the Marquis of Haikun and his wife's tombs as its center, which you can see in the largest one and the one to the right of it. And then this covers the area of 46,000 square meters. And it had it's walled on its 4 sides, and the walls, the perimeter reaches about 868 meters, and it is equipped with northern and eastern gates. Both are constructed together with 2 Chue pillars, 2 Chue towers, gate towers essentially. And then besides these, the cemetery includes 7 affiliated burials, and then 1. Chariot burials, storage burial, and then also remains of a variety of architectural foundations, and then finally it has roads and a drain system.
刘子亮先生在海丰红工地工作了一段时间，
所以我就熟悉了。 Thank you. I worked at the site for a little bit during last summer, so I kind of know a little bit about that.
现在有专家认为整个海丰红墓园包括紫禁城城址和那个西岸的长安城有某种关联，有某种联系，它的整个构造。
Some experts are theorizing that the construction of the Zijin City in Haifeng Kingdom has some kind of relation with the construction, the model of the Chang capital. So they're sort of related.
这是我们发掘的北门区域的一些考古遗迹的平面。
This is a plan of what we have found to the north side, around the north gate of the center.
这是北门址和北门址外对外面对称的双阙，从目前看来应该是属于双出阙。
So based on this our findings so far, it seems that this is the northern gate and it's equipped with two pillar gates, I'm sorry, pillar towers, Que towers, outing towers.
到时候有关阙的情况，我们叫南峰先生是特意专门有研究的。
So about the remains of Que, our expert Mr. Zhang Nanfeng here has his own research about this.
这是北门的门址的情况，这是北门的东门，这是东门门址的情况，这是东门的墓园墙以及东门外的对称的双阙以及之间的道路的遗迹。
This plan shows the eastern gate of the cemetery, and we can see the remains of two Que gate towers, as well as the symmetrically arranged, as well as the road in the middle.
整个海丰红墓园，在我们的在中国学术界，在西汉的时候，皇帝的帝陵以杨陵为代表，诸侯王陵以江苏大云山，须臾大云山的江都王墓为代表，它都有一个完整的陵园，但是。 在列侯这一集，有没有一个完整的陵园或者墓园？在海丰侯墓发掘之前，整个学术界并不是很清楚的。
So, in the past excavation, we have investigated the imperial mausoleum such as the Yangling, and then we have also investigated and excavated the Dayunshan Jiangdu Wangling, which is a sort of a king level mausoleum cemeteries, and these are sort of representative of the imperial as well as sort of king level burial systems. But whether the marquis level has its own cemetery or not, this has been a question up until the discovery of the marquis of Haifeng tomb.
海丰红墓发掘之后，我们至少可以得出这样的一个推论，就是在 海丰侯这样一个列侯和西汉的帝陵和诸侯王陵一样，它也是有一个完整的墓园的。So
after the discovery of the Haifeng Hou tomb and its cemetery, it's safe to speculate right now that the level of marquis also had a complete system of its cemetery construction.
这是海丰侯墓这次发掘的一个重要收获之一。This
is one of the key discoveries of our excavation this time.
同时，我们在这个墓园内还发现了大量的建筑基址，比如像海丰侯和海丰侯夫人墓的南面，发现了一个东西长100米、南北宽40米。 面积达4000平方米的一个高台的李自信建筑。So
the exhibition this time, we have also found a large amount of architectural remains inside the cemetery. And here, this map shows the Marcus Haifu's tomb and his wife's tomb. And to the south of it, we have around 4,000 square meters of area where we have a lot of ritual architectural remains.
这个李自新建筑由 F1、F2 以及 F1 和 F2 东西两边的厢房三部分构成。
So this remain consists of so F1 and F2, which is shown here on the map, which are offering 是是是房子吧？
厢两边是厢房。
Okay, two is both sides are the 厢complex. So it's like so they're like wing rooms on both sides.
目前学术界对这个李自新建筑有两种看法。第一种看法是以江南风先生、信义祥先生为代表的，他们认为 F1 是起 ，F2 是祠堂。
So there are two theories about two central structures, and the founded by scholars, including 江南by Dr. Mr. 江南风 and also Mr. 信义祥。Who believes that the F1 is the 起礼 and F2 is the offering shrine.
还第二种观点就是以刘瑞先生，他是根据乌宏先生的研究成果，认为 F1 是祠堂 ，F2 是起。
刘瑞 and who did his research based on Professor Wu Hong's research and believes that F1 is offering shrine, F2 is the 起礼。
一般对 F 一十三、F 一十四两边的厢房，一般都认为是原始立舍。
原始立舍，
原始立舍就是管理物的是。
原始。Okay, so and then the common theories about the two wing rooms on the two sides are they are sort of the quarters for the carers of the mosque.
这是 F 一。
This is F1
的情况。这是 F2 的回廊建筑的情况。
This is F2 with surrounding corridor, so you can sort of see in the plan.
这是主葬墓。
This
F4.
Is this is M4, one of the affiliated burials.
这是五号府葬墓的情况。
This is number five.
五号府葬墓一般的认为，根据帝陵和诸侯王陵现在的考古研究的成果。一般认为在一个墓园或者一个陵园里面只有墓主是男性，其他的都是女性，辅葬的是他的夫人或者妾。
So based on our discoveries, investigations of imperial mausoleums as well as our king's mausoleums, we have so far been thinking that in the cemeteries of these high-level cemeteries, only the tomb host is male, so the main tomb owner, and then all the affiliated tombs should be belongs to the concubines, or in other words, the female occupants.
但是海温侯墓的五号府葬墓，这里面出了一把剑。
But inside the tomb of the Marcus Haifun, in the M2. Tomb, we have discovered a sword.
剑的出土就产生了一个疑问。一般配剑的是指男性，女性是不配剑的，除非像那个富豪墓这种特殊身份的，那是一种例外。
Swords are discovered in male tombs, and it's very rarely, almost.Entirely not discovered in female tombs, except for special cases such as Fu Hao's tomb, who has very special social status.
所以这就给我们提出了一个疑问：是不是海温侯这样列侯的这个墓园，他的辅葬墓有可能是辅葬的是家族成员
？So this has raised some questions. Whether the cemetery of the Marcus level also included tombs of his male family members.
如果是辅葬的家族成员的话，我们的推测认为有可能是海丰侯那两个没有接到未成年的儿子的墓葬。
So, So one of our speculations is that these two tombs belongs to the two sons of the Marquess of Haihun who were underage and did not.
推荐他的继承人。
And one of the key responsibilities for the Taidong Dafu who came here to from the court to supervise is to appoint the next generation of Marquess of Haihun.
这个太宗大夫连续推荐了他两个儿子做继承人，这两个儿子就都推荐一个，他就死一个。So
sons that appointed by the Taidong Dafu sent to Liu He's funeral, both of them died right after the appointment.
说这样就在朝廷内就产生了争议。 就许许多多大臣就认为，这个昌邑王刘贺活着的时候，可能做多了坏事，老天都不让他有继承人。So
this has stimulated lively discussions in the central court, and many ministers thought that this is because the original Changyi king or Liu He, Marquess of Haihun, did so many bad deeds during his life. Now even the 老天爷 or heaven let out his successors have it their own way.
这就是文献记载的天王昌邑王族。So
this is what's recorded in historical texts as the heaven's erasal of the Changyi family.
宣帝就采纳了大臣的意见，把海昏侯国除国10年。
So Emperor Xuan then took the advice of these ministers and then erased the Haihun kingdom for a decade.
所有他的家人就瞬间就变成了平民。All
of his remaining families suddenly became commoners.
就这些带有王侯标志的遗物，是他的家人是不能够享用的。So
these burial goods that bears the symbols of very high status thus could not be used for their burials any longer, the family members.
对世商氏的太宗大夫来说，最简单的办法就是把所有这有带有王侯标志这个遗物埋进他的坟墓。So
therefore for the Taidong Dafu, the easiest way to take care of this business is basically bury everything that has high social status symbols together with the Liu He, Marquess of Haihun.
所以我们在这个海昏侯墓里面可以看到10,000多件套的这样非常丰富难得一见的文物，也是跟这个有关系的。Therefore,
this is also part of the reason why we were able to discover more than 10,000 pieces of really exquisite tomb burial goods inside Liu He's tomb.
有他当海昏侯的东西，有他当昌邑王的东西，还有他爸爸老昌邑王传给他的遗产，以及他可能甚至当皇帝从长安从宫廷里面带出来的东西，所有的这些我们在他这个海昏侯墓葬里面都可以看到这种种的一些迹象。We
may speculate that his burial goods included stuff that things that he obtained during his kingship at Changyi Kingdom, during his time as emperor in the Chang'an, as well as during his time as Marquess of Haihun. In other words, it was assembly of treasures from all of his life.
这是五号墓前面的祠堂的情况，建筑基址的情况。
This is okay. So this is the actual architectural remains that we can see in front of the. So it's M5 right in front.
这是他的一个外藏坑，就是陪车马坑。
So this is the chariot pit outside of Marquess of Haihun's tomb.
这个车马坑有几个特点。第一个，它是作为海昏侯墓的一个外藏国。
So it has a couple of features. The first is that this is the outer burial pit for the Haihun Hou's tomb.
它是用真车马进行那个陪葬的。
So the real chariots, life-size chariots, were buried inside this pit.
它里面出土了 五部车，五部高等级的安车和摇车，和大量的3000多件鎏金、错金、错金银、包金的车马器。
Inside this, we discovered five high-level chariots, including An chariots, Yao chariots, as well as more than 3,000 pieces of very exquisite chariot ornaments that are inlaid with gold or gold and silver or wrapped gold, etc.
根据一些我们发掘的一些马的痕迹来看，它至少一部车有4匹马。整个这个那个车马坑里面至少有20匹马以上。
So, based on our discoveries, there are each one of the chariots is drawn by about 4 horses, and then there are about 20 horses, remains of 20 horses inside it.
这也是中国长江以南第一次发现用真车马进行陪葬的一个车马坑。
This is the first time that we ever discover real chariots being buried in burial pits south of the Yangtze River.
海丰侯主墓，它整个封土高7米。
The tumulus of the 海丰侯 tomb has remaining height of 7 meters.
它的封土之下有一个400平方米的甲字形墓穴。
So underneath this tumulus is a 甲 shape, so Chinese character 甲 shape burial pit that has about 400 square meters of area.
同时，它是整个墓整个椁室由这几部分组成。
Burial chamber is consisted of the following couple compartments.
这是主椁室。
This is the main tomb chamber.
主椁室的北面、东面、西面环绕着长椁。
To the main chambers, north, east, and west directions, we have three elongated tomb chambers, storage chambers.
长椁与主椁室之间有过道。
There are passageways between the storage chambers and the main chambers.
它的它的南面有甬道。
And there's also a passageway to the south.
甬道两边是车马库。
To the left and right of the passageway, the entryway are chariot garages.
整个这个甬道和车马库都是欧车马。
And then what the chariots discovered inside are all old type of chariots.
整个主椁室是由两个室组成，由东室和西室组成。
The main tomb chamber has 2 compartments, the east and the west rooms.
东西室之间用门板用木板把它隔开，中间有一条过道，通道。
In the middle, a layer of wood wall was constructed to split the main chamber into the west and the eastern and parts, and then there's a gate created on this wall.
现在一般认为西室是寝，东室是寝，西室是堂。
So it's now believed that the west is the 寝, whereas the east is the 寝.
它的主棺是放在东室的东北面。
The coffin was placed to the in the northeast section of the 就是
东室
对 the east chamber.
在东西室的南面，它有门，还有门和窗。
So to the south of the main tomb chamber, we have windows and gates, doors.
这样一个椁室的构造，反映了西汉中晚期之后整个墓室的一个居室化或宅地化的现象。
This is an example where we can see that after the mid late Western Han, the tomb space has become more assimilated to the actual living conditions.
这是有关他回廊的一个回廊，它整个长椁是按照功能进行分区的。
So the long storage chambers on the sides are divided according to different functions, and also in the middle, you can see that original robber's tunnel dug into the meeting.
这是我们一个平面的示意图，它整个北长果是由前库、粮库、乐器库、酒曲库构成的。东长果主要是厨具库，西长果有衣饰库、武器库、文书档案库、娱乐用具库。它的甬道是属于月车库，两边是属于车马库。
So to the north we have a kind of vault for money, and then we have a grain vault, we have a musical instrument, and then we have wine vessels. And in the eastern storage chamber we have cooking utensils. And then on the west storage chamber we have weapons, excuse me, closet.And then a library, and finally a entertainment instrument chamber.
它的主棺是由内外两重棺构成。
The main tomb coffin of Liu He has two layers, the inner layer and the outer layer.
棺的侧面有帷帐，龙形的帷帐形挂钩，帷帐挂钩。
So, on the sides of the hook, we have a curtain hooks, bronze curtain hooks in shapes of dragon.
它的棺是放在一个有四个轮子上的棺床，我们称之为拱轴上面。
So the coffin is placed on four wheels, which we call 拱轴。
它这也反映了它当时的一个上葬的一个过程。
This also reflects a process in the mortuary institution.
这是。外棺盖打开，我们看到内棺盖的情况。
This is what we see after we open the lid of the outer coffin and look into the inner coffin.
这棺盖上面有纺织品的痕迹，初步就有分析认为可能是属于方文一类的。
So on the surface of the inner coffin, we have discovered remains of fabrics, which we believe probably.Belong to a Fang Wei type curtain, a fabric adornment to the coffin.
在它的南面有一只神鸟。
To its south, we have this decoration of a mystical bird.
在内外观之间出现了非常精美的贴金片的漆箱，以及大量的马蹄金、菱齿金、金饼和金板。
So in the space in between the inner and outer coffins, we have discovered many pieces of exquisite lacquerware boxes decorated with gold leaves, and as well as a large amount of horse-shaped gold ingot, 麒麟头-shaped gold ingot, and also gold plates and gold cakes, a lot of gold.
就是内棺运进实验室里面，在实验室里面打开内棺盖的一个情况。
This is the photo of the inside of the coffin after we have taken the coffin, packaged it and transferred into the laboratory and opened and we took this picture.
我们在这内棺盖打开之后，我们看到的就是刘贺遗骸的痕迹。
So here we see the remains of Liu He's body.
在他的头部的南面是十几个精美的贴金片的漆链，也跟发簪盒有关系。
漆链。So about two next to its close its head. To the south of its head, we discover around 10.Lacquer lien, which holds the sort of hair to doing the hair. It's like cosmetic box. Yeah, about 10 of them.
在他的头上覆盖着一个镶玉璧的漆面罩。
So on its head, his head was covered by a lacquered 面罩 the face mask that had a jade disc.Embedded in the middle.
遗骸上面还覆盖着大小不等、整齐排列的玉璧。
And on his body, we have discovered a large amount of neatly organized and placed set of jade discs.
在他的腰部位置，我们发现了他的梳刀以及玉器卷和佩戴的玉佩。
So close to his waist area, we have discovered this book knife as well as jade pendants.
最重要的是在他的在他这个腰部的这个位置。腰间发现了写有刘贺名字的玉印一枚。
The most important discovery here is a jade seal placed close to his waist, which bears the inscription of a name of 刘贺。
这是刘贺遗骸的痕迹，头部，它是这两边是玉枕。
So this is the shot of the head area, and to both sides we have what used to be a jade pillow.
这是他遗骸头部的情况。最重要的是，遗骸只有痕迹，但是我们发现了他有一个完整的一个牙齿。
So, here is another shot of the head area. And what's really important here is that although remains of his body has disappeared, we were able to find his remains of his teeth.
有牙齿，我们就可以做很多体质人类学的分析，可以知道。他平时喜欢吃什么食物，什么疾病啊，年龄多大，这个都可以做一系列的体质的问题的检测。
Once we have the teeth, we can do a lot of biological analysis that would give us information about what he ate, like to eat, and what kind of disease he had, and his age, etc. So we can obtain a lot of information from this.
更重要的一点，目前是中国社会科学考古研究所。包括吉林大学以及复旦大学对这个牙齿进行了一个提取，准备去做 DNA 的一个检测。
What's also really important is that now the Archaeological Institute at TAS, Chinese Academy of Social Science, and then a University of Jilin as well as University of Fudan University, they're working together to perform a DNA analysis from a sample of the teeth.
如果一旦结果出来，据他们这些专家告诉我，一旦结果出来，对我们的科学研究是有帮助的，而且对我们现代的生活也有一定的意义，就是可以知道我们中国现在的哪一个姓刘的是原来这一支血脉。
So once we figure this out, it actually has some impact on our real life because this will.Help us determine which your family today, which your family is related to the original material.
好，我们同时在他的他的腹部还发现了食物的残留。
So we were also able to discover remains of food in his abdominal area.
从现在目前这个残留物已经进行了提取。由社科院赵志军先生他们已经进行了提取，分析结果还没出来，但是从形状和外表上看，它成分析它是属于香瓜子一类的。
So now the archaeological institute at TAS is doing赵德军 professor is doing an analysis of this remain and but from the shape of and determined by its shape we areSuspecting that this was sort of a 香瓜, it's kind of a summer watermelon melon.
这就非常有意思了。我们知道马王堆，新追夫人死之前是吃香瓜的。
Also know that 新追夫人 tomb host of 马王堆 tomb number one also ate 香瓜 before she died.
海昏侯刘贺死之前也吃了香瓜。
And then 刘贺 apparently before his death also ate 香瓜。
这代表着一个什么样的信心？所以，同时还有专家建议我们对这个香瓜子进行检测的时候，还要鉴定它有没有毒。
So other experts have suggested to.Investigate whether the 香瓜 remains contain any toxic components.
因为在江西靖南春秋有一个墓葬里面，他的那些随葬的那个女性，都是在死之前 吃了香瓜籽，而且是有毒的香瓜。
This is because we have also discovered tombs in Jiangxi dating to the spring and autumn period, and the female affiliated tombs belong to females in that cemetery. We found that similarly the remains of Xiangwa, which was marred with poison, which means that they was sort of poisoned to death.
吉林大学朱红他们先生他们的团队就在那个春秋，就静安春秋大地，就发现了有绿色的结晶体。
So the professor in the University of Jilin has discovered in this tomb that similar to the tomb that there were crystals of green colors.
所以在我们海分红这个，他也发现了有绿色结晶体的东西。
In the Haihunhou tomb, we also discovered traces of this green crystal.
所以专家提示我们对这个香瓜籽进行有没有毒的检测是有一定道理的。
Therefore, it makes sense for the experts to suggest that we perform some kind of analysis for this green, the 香瓜 seed.
如果真检测出来有毒，也可能涉及到文献还没有记载到的一个非常重大的一个病例。
If we were to find traces of poison, then we have discovered information that's not passed down to historical texts.
从目前的情况下，估计有毒的可能性不大。
Based on current findings, we don't think it has it's like very likely that it's poison.
就是海分红遗骸下面的包金丝缕的琉璃席。
So this is the kind of a mat. It's lapis lazuli mat with gold wrapped thread. So it's pieces of lapis lazuli weave together with gold wrapped thread, and it's sort of laid down underneath his body as a mat.
它有324片琉璃组成。
It has
384片。
It has 384 pieces. It's lapis lazuli sewn together.
它整个鞋子周围还有云母的包边。
So it has to the four sides. It also have 云母 mica, right? Decorations of mica.
这同时，这个琉璃席，这个琉璃实际上就是铅背玻璃，铅背，它的成分主要是铅背的成分。
铅背啊。千倍。哦，千倍，千倍。Right. So the lapis lazuli is created mainly with lead, as well as beige.
金字旁加一个贝。
哦，金贝。It's another kind of metal.
Yeah. 贝。贝。这海分红这个琉海分红的琉璃发现了两种。一类就是，那个琉璃席，就是还这个琉璃席的这个成分是以铅背，为主要成分。还有一类就是镶嵌在马蹄金、鳞齿金上面的琉璃，是钠钙玻璃，这两个不相同的成分。
All right, Chris, you have to help me out here with that lapis lazuli. There are two kinds of lapis lazuli discovered in the tomb. And one kind is what we find in this lapis lazuli mat. The other kind we find in the lapis lazuli sort of embedded in the horse-shaped, horseshoe-shaped ingot, gold ingots, and the cheating pole ingots. And then they have two different, these two kinds have two different types of chemical composition. This mat has qian and bei, so lead and bei. And the other
barium.
Thank you. Barium. And then the kind in the ma ti jin and qi lin, it has nasium. Yes. Calcium is sodium.
铅背玻璃这个技术一直在我们中国在西周时候就有，但是这种技术一直是掌握在皇室手上，是民间是看不到的， 如果一旦民间看到，他认为比喻还贵。
So the technique of making this kind of lead barium lapis lazuli, it was already present in China since the Western Zhou Dynasty, but it was very restricted, highly restricted to the imperial court. So it wasn't really seen to the public, accessible to the public, and it was valued more than jade.
好，在整个在琉璃石下面是100块金币。
Beneath the this lapis lazuli mat are placed 100 pieces of gold cake.
它整个果实的果木上面还有许多写有邓长公墓这些题记，反映了春秋以来的木热功名记录。
So on the wooden components of the tomb chamber, we also discovered inscriptions bearing the information about the artisans, so which reflects kind of this tradition of showing the makers since the spring and autumn period.
包括我们看到邓长公三尺九是实际上是实际上是指原木的直径，在我们汉简里面有一个以原裁方，斜七方五的这样的一个记载，这是指裁成这个方木的原木的直径。
Okay. So so for example, on the on this we have Deng Zhang Gong
San
Chi Jiu. So this inscription kind of tells you the diameter of the original wood created, and we have relevant historical inscriptions about these diameters and regulations for them.
这边有同时还有五下东市这样的一个这种符号，这是一个墓底的解剖的一个情况，这是墓底两就是墓壁上用那个竹鞭进行复壁的情况。
So, in the earlier pictures, we had inscriptions of other inscriptions that's seen in the.
这是有关他门，墓道的那个门的情况，门上的扶手。
So that was the shot of a passageway, and this is the 扶手 or the 手手衔环 on the door.
目前出土了11000余件套文物。
So far, there has been more than 10,000 pieces of burial pieces found.
有关这个文物，有关这么多文物，它实际上我们所说的汉墓十室九空，在古代这个墓葬也被盗过，但是都没有成功。
So as we said, there's the saying goes, 9 out of 10 tombs are ancient tombs are looted. It's empty. But and as the saying goes, this tomb was also robbed many times in its history, but none of them was successful.
这里有两个重要的原因，就是海昏侯墓，海昏侯下葬之后，就在东晋的时候发生了一次地震，把整个国史震塌了。
So there's a key reason for this, for its completeness and safety. It's because around the Eastern Qing period, there was a major earthquake in the area, which completely crushed part of the.
同时，从南朝刘宋，因为这次地震，从南朝刘宋开始，整个地质情况发生了变化，造成鄱阳浮水，从南朝刘宋开始不断的南侵。
So also during the 刘宋dynasty, the geological conditions of the area also changed, and which consisted of the southernward movement of the 鄱阳湖water body,
使整个海昏侯墓里面就泡所有的出土的遗物，所有的遗物随葬品泡在水里。
So this has caused the entire tomb chamber to be submerged in underground water.
水有一个最重要的作用，就是绝氧的功能。所以我们在2000年以后还可以看到大量的漆器和竹简的情况。
The water has a magical effect of we are able to see so many beautiful objects preserved, especially lacquer today.
这同时给古代的盗墓者也造成了巨大的困难。整个国史坍塌了，里面又充满着水，所以古代是又不具备水下盗墓的条件，所以也就造成他们最后放弃了，对这个墓葬没有造成一个大的破坏。
This has caused a lot of troubles for the ancient tomb looters who weren't really equipped with devices to conduct underwater looting.
这是汉代鄱阳湖水师的情况。
So this is the 鄱阳湖in Han.
这是到了这是宋代鄱阳湖水师的情况。
So this is Song Dynasty.
就形成了鄱阳湖水的南支。
So you can see that.
这是属于我们现在看到的一个鄱阳湖水的情况。
This is modern day. So you can through these three illustrations, you can see the movement, southernward movement of 鄱阳湖 water.
这是一个 DM 的效果图。这是50米范围内的现在看到的一个鄱阳湖的一个情况。好，这里面有大量5000枚竹简。
So there are more than 5,000 pieces of bamboo slips in this room.
其中涉及到内容有《论语》。
It includes《论语》。
礼记。礼记和易经，
易经 Book of Change，
六博棋谱
，and then a play manual for 六博，
医书
，and then a medical text，
以及注目的赋《悼亡赋》
，and then a rhapsody for the construction of the tomb。
论语我们发现了有知道篇名的简。
Among the 论语 bamboo slips, we have found a bamboo slip that's titled with a 知道。
我们初步判断，这可能就是失传1800年的《论语》的齐论版本。
We currently we speculate that this is the 齐 version of the 论语 which has been lost entirely for 1800 years.
齐论和鲁论和古论的最大区别就是多了两篇，一个知道和一个问王。
The difference between the Qi version of 论语 and the Lu version and the Gu version, the other two we have today, is that the Qi version includes two additional passages. One of them is 知道, which we just saw.
海昏侯墓里面发现的《论语》，实验是目前中国看到随葬《论语》最早的一个墓。
So the 论语 that we find is in the 海昏 tomb is the earliest
齐论语最
早的齐论语the analect we find here is the earliest version of 齐论语 that we discovered.
它具有重要的版本学意。
It has very important impact in the study of text.
使我们可以看到西汉时期的典籍和先秦时期的那个儒家典籍之间的关系。
This sort of illustrates to us the relationship between Western Han texts and the preaching period texts.
同时也可以让我们重新审视原来考古发掘过程当中出土的一些论语的可以识别它论语的版本的一个情况。
It also helps us to determine different versions of analects excavated in other earlier tombs.
比如监水关的论语的论语，以及那个定州八角楼的中山怀王刘修佑出土的论语，这种情况，等于说可以确认它的版本。
For example, this could be used to help determine the versions of the 监水关 version of analect as well as the 八角楼 version.
这是最早的六博棋谱。
This is the earliest play manual for 六博。
这我们可以看到，这是白纸从出位向下到棒，这是前面一个第一张就是白纸由出位向内到位。
Based on these texts, we can
白出内道。
So 白出内道 ，this text we can kind of recreate the movement of the white chess across the board.
青纸由高位向下 到专位，到半位。
As well as the movement of the blackness from the 高 position to the 专 position.
白石青，白子吃掉黑子。
And then we can also see that the white chest eats the dark black one.
最后白子赢。
And then the white one wins.
我们这是根据隐湾汉墓的隐湾汉墓出土的《国君章》《西京杂记》以及北京北大床简床竹书谱进行的一个复原。
So this reconstruction is based on the Yinwan TOB or Liu Bo divination instructions, as well as the Xijing Zaji records in Xijing Zaji, and also texts in Beida regarding the Zhu Shu Wu, regarding the Liu Bo. This is the medical text, and this one particularly is about the art of bed chamber.
它是在马王堆天下至道坛八道的基础上增加了两道虚实这两道。
So this in 马王堆 we have similar texts, but that one had eight methods. This one increased two more methods to it, in total, so it has 10 十道。And then the addition is 虚 and 实。
反映了房中术在西汉中晚期之后的，从西汉早期向中晚期之后的一个发展的一个过程。
So this text reflects the development of the bed chamber manuals since the mid-late Western Han period.
简牍里面还有另外一种就是木牍。木牍分两类，一类是奏牍，奏牍是海昏侯和海昏侯夫人写给皇帝和皇太后的奏章。
So among the inscribed slips we discovered in tomb includes this body of wooden slips, and they're divided into two kinds. One is the report to the central imperial court by the wives of Liu He, as well as Liu He.
上面有南方海昏侯陈赫奏妹子在拜皇帝陛下和元康四年六月新闻，还有海昏侯夫人妾带妹子在拜太后陛下的一些文字。这是还有一类奏牍，就是签牌，是记在墓室或者漆箱上的标签，写明成器的编号及所成物品的名称和数量等等。同时，这是签上面的签牌上面的记载的系列服袍一两，什么筒袜啊、筒布圆袜一两，这些可能我们没见到的一些纺织品，在这个签牌里面都有记录。
So some of these these wooden slips include information about what kind of fabrics was and clothes were buried inside the tomb, and these could provide information to us about what.It's already gotten away that we don't see anymore in the tombs, especially fabrics.
这就是我们发现的衣襟。
This is the dressing mirror that we have found inside.
当时的发现，我们开始认为可能是屏风，后面是因为发现他们上面有一个符，上面就写了衣襟符。
So originally we thought this was a screen, lacquered screen, but based on the inscription on the lacquer piece, we know that the title says it's Yijing Fu, Rhapsody for the Dressing Mirror, so we know that it's the dressing mirror.
这是整个衣襟的构造，它是由衣襟、襟背和襟眼，这还有襟架这几部分构成。
This is a structure of a reconstructed structure of the dressing mirror. It has the mirror, the back support, and then the frame as well as a cover.
这是衣襟上的镜子，这是高光谱的一个图像。
So here we have an image of the mirrors front and back.
这上面写有衣襟符。
So this is the rhapsody of the dressing mirror.
这个衣襟上最主要的特点是让我们看到了最早的孔子画像。
what's really important about this dressing mirror is that on the back of it, we find the earliest portrait of Confucius.
这个镜背上有孔子及其弟子的画像和他们的生平事迹。
Here we have portraits of Confucius and his disciples, accompanied by inscriptions of telling their biographic stories.
它涉及到孔门弟子的有八个人，有八个人。这是孔子，这是颜回，下面是子张、子干、子路，这下面是子羽和子夏。
It includes portraits of eight disciples of Confucius.
这是最早的孔子的画像。
This is the earliest depiction of Confucius.
在他的镜框上面有最早的东王公的形象。
So on top of this mirror, we have the earliest depiction of the King Father of the East.
这是在他的镜盖的外面有那个镜盖的表面有钟子听琴的形象。
This is a illustration of 钟子期 listening to the zither on the front cover of the manuscript.
在他的镜盖里面是曾子和子张。
This is on the outside and inside we have portraits of 曾子和子张。
这涉及到的人物有八个人，总共的文字1850个字。
There are information about eight figures included on the dressing mirror, and the inscription totals 1850 words.
好，海文侯墓葬里面出土的金器总共是487件，重达115公斤。
So the amount of number of gold pieces discovered in the tomb totals to 487 pieces, and then they weigh 115 kilograms in total.
这是马蹄金，这是鳞齿金，这鳞齿金上镶嵌的琉璃，就是我们所说的烂盖玻璃。这是金笔，上面有墨书“海昏侯陈赫”，重黄金一斤。这是金饼上的刻画符号和题记，这是金板。整个海昏侯墓里面出土的黄金，它有这几个特点：马蹄金、鳞齿金是写祥瑞的一个纪念品，是汉武写祥瑞的纪念品。
So there are some important features of this horseshoe ingot, gold ingot, as well as the 麒麟 tall shaped gold ingot. They are sort of a symbol of 祥瑞 or auspicious sign, heavenly signs.
那个金饼和金板是作为海昏侯的准备黄金。
Whereas the gold cakes and the gold plates are this sort of a gold reserve.
它是一个具有储藏功能的硬通货。
It has a value as the a hard currency.
同时它还有一个最重要的特点，就是重金质。
And then, these gold pieces also reflect a very important institution during the Han Dynasty, which is the Zhou gold.
玉器大约500余件。
About 500 pieces of jade pieces discovered.
这是刘贺的玉印。
It's the seals of 刘贺。
是有专家分析是反映了他27天皇帝的记忆。
So some experts have said that this reflects his memory as an emperor for 27 years.
他主要是从这个钮是一个枭纽来说的。
So this is based on the fact that the knot on the jade seal is in the shape of an oar.
大刘记忆反映了他是回到昌邑的十年庶民生活的记忆。
On the right, we have the seal for 大刘记忆。This is a reflection of his life as a commoner for 10 years.
这是玉璧、玉圭、玉圆、玉具件上的玉玉具件上的玉手、玉格、玉尾、玉件质和玉件玉尾和玉件璧，这是色心佩的情况。这色心佩有三枚色心佩， 这是腰部腰部的一个玉佩饰，大量的带钩以及玉石剑，就是双虎石兽的一个玉石剑，这大量的这种玉石的装饰，玉饰和玉主佩，这是一个，这也是一个玉石和玉耳杯，也是玉山水晶玛瑙，玛瑙的配饰，这是四发红玉碎珠类的，像天珠类的这种，这可能都是属于和中西文化交流的产物。
Also, the one you just saw was kind of reflection of Han Empire's interaction with the Western, Inner Asian, and then further Western world.
这是琥珀。
That was amber.
整个海昏侯的玉器，它主要的特点是三个。第一，它大量的是和田玉。
So, there are three features for these jade pieces. And then the first one is that most of them are from the Khotan area.
还有第二个特点就是很多玉是春秋战国时候的。
And the second feature is that most of the jade pieces, many of them are from the Spring and Autumn.
还有春秋战国与西汉的玉的一个结合在一起的。
There are also examples of Western Han fusion, fusion of Western Han jade and Spring and Autumn jade. So it's Western Han maybe repair or intentional remake.
有很多很多玉不是一般的诸侯王和列侯能用的，很多只有皇帝才能用。
Many of these pieces cannot be just used at will by a marquis level aristocrat. It has to be used by imperial, like emperor level.
卢兆英先生和古方先生专门对这个玉进行了一个初步的一个研究。
So, Dr. Lu and Lu Zhaoying and then Gu Fang, these are jade experts, have been studying these jade pieces.
这大量的钱币，200万枚，重达10多吨的钱币。
So here we have about 2 million pieces of coin, which are about tens of tons.
这上面有那个风铃匣，苍蝇的风铃匣。而且这个钱币。我们发现了以千文为一贯等于说对货币的一个计量。
So among these coins, we find that 1 yuan equals to 1,000 coins stringed together.
从目前发现的情况来看，千文为一贯没有形成定制，真正形成定制是唐宋。
This reflects the ritual system where the king level can have 3 sides of musical instruments arranged for him on his 3 sides, whereas the king, the emperor level would have, the son of heavens would be able to have 4 sides. So it's a reflection of the ritual.
这是编钟，编钟上面的钮钟，这是编磬，这套编磬是铁编磬。
So these chimes is actually made of iron.
让我们对汉代的冶铁工业应该有一个新的认识。
This provides new clues for our study of iron making during the Western Han Dynasty.
这个钟具，磬具，这夜余灯，这写有苍翼、吉田等铭文的斗形灯。南昌铭文的灯，这上面灯的铭文，这是昌邑吉田底，东周的否，西周的提梁有，这反映了海昏侯当时还有一个收藏古物的习惯。
So, as you just saw, some of the burial goods are from the Eastern Zhou, and in this case, from the Western Zhou. So we can see that 海昏侯 Marcus 海昏 had the hobby of antique collecting.Is it okay to take 10 more minutes?
到时间了。这是权。
It's权啊，这位。
这是砝码。
啊，位啊 ，set of weight。
这是蒸煮器和温鼎，其中这个蒸煮器就是有先生认为 可能与蒸馏白酒有关系的蒸馏器，但是这是从里面来说，就是赵作清先生里面发现了它的残留物是芋头，是芋头就不得不让人想到和蒸馏白酒有关系。
So on the these are you see that it, on the left is distiller, on the right is tripod for feeding, and there's something special about this distiller, which is that inside of this they were able to discover yutou, which is a kind of
taro,
right? Yeah. So taro, which is kind of we cannot not think about baijiu this distillation finding that. So this was could have originally been the distiller for liquor.
啊，这是奶炉，这是博山炉。这种熏炉以及归正以及习正，这是写有日光和清白铭文的铜镜、海之印、滴漏以及当炉错金银的当炉车尾横车马轴丝件、乐丝件、横丝件总共发现的漆器大约有三千多件。
About 3,000 pieces of tobacco was discovered.
这是写有一公五药汤的漆盘，以及礼具、契耳杯和围棋盘，这上面。有石棺、朝府瑞等文字的漆器，成套的契耳杯，夹柱胎的漆盘以及蓄音碗、漆勺、漆链。三指链、九指链、贴金片的九指链、九指链上的贴金片的纹饰，以及女人人物的图像，这是贴金片的漆链。同时还发现了面台、七弦琴。
So this is a zither with seven strings, lacquer.
以及木俑。和写有昌邑九年的画盾，以及漆饰和漆色上的文字，昌邑九年、昌邑十年、昌邑七年，这是陶器、罐盒、鼎、瓦当以及漆皮的陶片，漆皮陶，这是大量的粮库里面的鼠鼠稻麻的这是虫草类的药材。好，最后向大家报告的是第三部分理念。我们这次考古发掘最大的一个重要的理念是按照把这个遗址把它作为一个遗址来发掘，按照大遗址和世界文化遗产的标准来进行考古工作的。
So, this is the third part, which is I'm going to report you about the ideas for our excavation this time. For the excavation of this site, we are taking the standard of UNESCO World Heritage as our own principles.
所以我们在考古发掘之初就有制定了一个详细的考古工作技术路线。
So from the very onset of the excavation, we have meticulously planned the entire process.
它的路径就是从由城墓葬群到墓园，最后到墓葬，是一个这样的路径。
So we took this not only the tomb, but also the Zijin City, the formation Zijin City as a whole. So the excavation plan considers that as a whole, so it proceeds from the larger scale, which is the city, and then zooms into the cemeteries, and then finally to individual tombs. So it has this progression of different levels.
所以我们整个考古工作分成四阶段，第一阶段就是进行紫禁城和墓园的调查和勘探。我们发现的。有完整的墓园，以及等于说海丰侯的聚落遗址。 第二部分，第二阶段就是我们进行墓园的发掘，先发掘墓园内的车马坑以及府葬墓。第三个阶段我们才发掘总墓，先进行封土的发掘，然后进行国史的发掘，最后进行墓底的发掘。第四个阶段就是实验室考古阶段，所有提取的东西进入实验室，在实验室里面进行清理。好，每一个阶段我们都制定了详细的工作方案和工作议案。
For every step that you just mentioned, they have a very detailed progression plan.
数十家高等院校和科研机构参与了这次的发掘。
Tens of institutions were involved in the excavation this time.
国家文物局专门设立了专家组，在现场指导发掘工作。
The National Heritage Agency has set up an expert team dedicated to the excavation of the tomb.
每个阶段都进行了有专家的认证。
Every step was accompanied by expert discussion as well as sort of proof.
我们发掘的第二个理念的第二个特点是非常重视文物的现场保护。
The second characteristics of our excavation is we are really devoted to the on-site conservation preservation of the objects.
我们把考古发掘人员和文物保护人员结合在一起，共同参与到文物的提取工作当中。
We have combined the archaeologists experts as well as the conservation experts together, sort of ready on site when we conducted this.
我们对那个对那个脆弱之文物和埋藏关系复杂的文物采取实验室套箱提取的方法。
So for very complicated objects and such as the coffin complex, we took the method of packaging it, and then bringing the laboratory and then proceed to excavate there.
好，我们所有提取出来的文物要先在现场进行应急保护，最后才进入这个文物专门的一个实验室里面进行专门的文物保护。
So all of the artifacts excavated, we would perform a rescue on-site conservation first, and then they are transferred to this base of research and conservation where the laboratory is located.
按文物保护专家的话来说，就是所有出土的文物先进急诊室，再进住院部。
So, the words of the excavation experts, all the artifacts goes to the ER room first, and then go into the next room.
在整个第三个第三里面的第三个特点，就是我们在发掘过程当中就充分考虑了今后的展示和利用。
The third characteristic is that during our excavation, we have taken in full consideration the possible future display and presentation of the site.
比如对墓壁进行永久性的加固。
For example, we have reinforced the tomb walls in a perpetual way.
一般的情况下，就是我们发掘墓一个这么大的墓大型墓葬发掘完进行一个保护的情况下，都是要回填的。
In usual cases, after excavation, we would usually bury it back.
对墓壁进行了永久性加固，这个墓葬就不需要回填的，就直接为以后的展示打下了一个基础。
After the reinforcement of the tomb walls, we no longer need to bury it again, and then they can use straight into for display presentation and.
好，我们比如对偶车马的实验室考古，以及对铜钱的实验室考古，都是为了以后能够复原回那个墓室，为以后的展示服务。
So, our conservation of the coins as well as the model chariots has the goal of recreating them in their original state, and then putting them back into the tomb space for future display.
这是在 江西这是国家也准备在这个海丰侯做一个国家考古遗址公园，这是一个概念设计。
This is a concept design for the national archaeological park that's going to be built on site.
第四个特点是海丰侯墓的发掘大量使用了新技术。
The fourth characteristic of the excavation is that it employs a myriad of new technologies.
考古发掘阶段的，比如地球物理探测技术、三维测绘技术，是我们在整个海丰侯墓园设置了9000多个测空点，有一个测空网，就是海丰侯墓园里面出土的任何一件遗物都有自己的一个三维坐标。可以复原以后的，包括地表的那种情况，都能够进行复原。
For example, we used advanced technologies in GIS as well as 3D scanning of the not only the tomb but also the cemetery site. And then we have set up over 9,000 scanning spots inside this area, which means that every single object excavated from this discovered network would have its own pinpointed location inside this digital network, which will be helpful for future reconstruction of the tomb site and for design of the exhibit, etc.
航拍、三维扫描、延时摄影技术，我们文物保护阶段的碳伤的技术 ，X 光成像技术，高光谱。红外扫描技术以及冲弹保护技术，就低氧气条链技术，这是我们在海丰侯墓里面首次使用一个航天工业的一个技术手段，把它运用在这里面。
Okay, so we want to emphasize that they employed sort of aerospace technology during the in the conservation of海丰侯。Excavation this time.
最初的设想就是一单由纺织品以及尸骸这些有机质的文物如果出现的话，就立即进入这个低氧舱，延缓空气中的氧气对这个文物的破坏。
The original idea was that once we discover any trace of remains of fabrics and then weavings, etc., we would move them immediately to this low oxygen environment so that the damage to the artifact would be reduced to the minimum.
好，同时还使用了泥土分离剂、薄荷醇这些提取的技术，以及浮雪检测分析的技术，包括最后一些结果。海丰侯这个墓园主要是以侧板板树和枫树作为一个墓园的景观的。
So they use柏树 and 枫树 ，so that would be maple and cypress.For the landscape designing of the tomb area.
这是中国科学院大学的一个研究成果。
哦，这是保护。
对，就是他从那个植物这个遗骸里面，等于说检测出，就是等于说这检测出来这是什么植物，这样发现整个海丰侯墓园。
I'm sorry. The landscape design was the original Western Han Dynasty landscape design for the cemetery. It was originally covered with cypress as well as maple trees, based on the analysis of the.
第四部分向大报将报告的是价值。
The fourth part is the value.
海丰侯墓园是我国迄今发现的保存较完好、结构较完整。布局较清晰，拥有纪实遗存的西汉列侯墓园，对于研究西汉列侯墓园的园寝制度具有重大意义。
So the meaning of value and meaning of the cemetery of the Marcus Typhoon is that it is a well-preserved tomb complex. The arrangement of its structure is complete, and the overall layout of the complex is clearly defined. It also preserved the remains of ritual architecture.Given it great importance for the study of the tomb system, mortuary system of the Marcus Rank during the Western Han Dynasty.
南昌西岸海丰侯墓是我国长江以南地区发现的唯一一座带有真车马陪葬坑的墓葬， 其墓葬本体规模宏大，椁室设计严密，结构复杂，功能清晰明确，对于研究认识西汉列侯等级葬制提供了难得的资料。
The Western Han tomb of the Marquis of Haifeng in Nanchang is the only tomb in the south of Yangtze River excavated so far to include a sacrificial pit.
迄今已出土的一万余件文物，形象再现了西汉时期高等级贵族的生活，具有很高的历史价值、艺术价值和科学价值。大量工艺精湛的文物，体现了汉代手工业高超的技术水平。以紫禁城、海丰侯墓园以及大平民墓地和贵族墓地为核心的海丰侯国的遗址具有重要的展示和利用价值。好，我的报告完了。谢谢。